Pray, Father, lead and direct us from this point. Let everything we do be done to your will and to your glory. Father, your will be done, not my will, not our will, but your will be done. Father, we give you praise. We give you the glory today. We thank you, God, for beginning the good work within us. And you who have begun the good work, you shall continue to perform it. Father, our eyes are upon you. You're the author, you're the finisher. You're the one that begun the good things within us, and you're the one that will bring them to completion. Father, we give you praise and we give you the glory in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Everybody just say, in Jesus' name. Amen. I get excited every time I say in the name of Jesus, because there's healing, there's peace, there's joy. Amen. All that we need is in that name. Just rejoice this morning, because Jesus is that name. Hallelujah. The scripture says God has given him a name, and that name is above every name. Hallelujah. At the name of Jesus, every knee has to bow and every tongue must confess that Jesus is Lord. Amen. Everybody said, Jesus is Lord. That means he's Lord over your circumstances. How many are dealing with some type of challenge, some type of situation? How many are dealing with something? Amen. How many believe that Jesus is greater than your circumstance? Hey, oh, Christ in you. Amen. We have something on the inside of us. Christ in us, the hope of glory. Oh, Christ in us. How many glad that Christ is in us? Christ is in us. Oh, he's in there to help us. He's there to lead us. He's there to guide us. He's there to give us whatever we need. Hallelujah. Christ in you, the hope of glory. We just praise God for his presence, his power, his anointing, and all that he's doing. Amen. I'm glad that he's the one that begun the good work within us. And he who hath begun the good work shall continue to perform it. Amen. We just thank God for his goodness this morning. We thank God for all of our musicians this morning. Now, Sister Stephanie. Amen. She said she don't have to stand. Everybody knows that. Stephanie. All right. And this is Brother Lamar. Yeah, as well as I know. All right. I thought he was on bass. You were? Okay. Oh, he switched to, all right. And then Brother Dean Heath. Amen. Amen. Brother Derek Hill on drums. And all of the singers, hallelujah. We just praise God for each and every one of them. Amen. All right, how many love our singers? How many appreciate our singers? Amen. How many believe it would be worth to take them all out for dinner sometimes? I didn't get that many hands then. You enjoy them. All right, well, I guess you still appreciate them. All right, I'm going to talk this morning about expanding your capability to believe. This is kind of a little detour from what we started last week. Last week, we mentioned the fourth step, which was allowing the Holy Spirit to show us the end results of what we would be and what we are to do. But before we can understand exactly that point, probably it might be good for us to back up a little bit and share with you some things that will enable you to expand your capability to believe God's word. Amen. This might not be a message that you feel that you might need, but God can't do any more for us than what we can believe him to do. Scripture says, if thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that what believe. That's Mark 9:20. If thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that what? That believe. And there are some things that limit our ability to believe. And we're going to kind of share with you this morning some of those things which kind of limit our ability to believe God's word. And I think everybody will agree that the scripture says, as a man doth what? Thinketh in his heart, so is what? He. Amen. Everybody repeat that. As a man what? Thinketh in his heart what? So is he. So you want to understand that thinking, everybody just said thinking. Thinking reflects how you see yourself, and what you believe. Amen. Thinking reflects how you see yourself and what you believe. And all of us understand that we make decisions based on what we what we believe. Amen. How we see ourselves and what we believe. That's how we make choices, make decisions on the basis of how we see ourselves on the inside and how we believe. Amen. I guess one of the best illustrations that you could probably find would be in Numbers. You would just look over there. Numbers. Everybody turn to Numbers. Numbers 13, we can see exactly what we are trying to get over here. Verse 26, this is the story of the 10 spies that were sent over into the promised land. And they were sent there to bring back a report concerning the country. What they found, the conditions, the circumstances that existed. So there were 12 spies that were sent. And verse 26 says, and they went and came to Moses and to Aaron and to all of the congregation of the children of Israel unto the wilderness of Paran to Kadesh, and brought back word unto them and unto all of the congregation, and showed them the fruit of the land. Amen. So this is the report that were communicated to Moses and to Aaron. Verse 27, they said this, and they told him and said, we came into the land whither thou sentest us, and surely it floweth with milk and honey, and this is the fruit of it. Nevertheless, the people be strong that dwell in the land. And the cities are walled and very great. And moreover, we saw the children of Anak there. The Amalekites dwell in the land of the south. And the Hittites and the Jebusites and the Amorites dwell in the mountains. And the Canaanites dwell by the sea and by the coast of Jordan. And Caleb stilled the people before Moses and said, let us go up at once and possess it, for we are well able to overcome it. See, this, it was God's will for the children of Israel to go right into the promised land without hesitation. He never meant for them to take 40 years. It was about a 40-day journey, and God wanted them to go immediately over and possess the land. Okay, verse 31, but the men that went up with him said, we be not able to go against the people, for they are stronger than we. They are stronger than we. And they brought up an evil report of the land which they had searched unto the children of Israel, saying, the land through which we have gone to search it It is a land that eateth up the inhabitants thereof, and all the people that we saw in it are men of great stature. And there we saw the giants, the sons of Anak, which come of the giants. And we were in our sight, and we were in our own sight as grasshoppers, and so we were in their sight. Okay, let me just read a little further. And all the congregation lifted up their voice and cried, and the people wept that night, and all the children of Israel murmured against Moses and against Aaron. And the whole congregation said unto them, would God that we had died in the land of Egypt, or would God we had died in this wilderness? And wherefore hath the Lord brought us into this land to fall by the sword, that our wives and our children should be a prey? Were it not better for us to return into Egypt? And they said one to another, let us make a captain, and let us return into Egypt. Then Moses and Aaron fell on their faces before all the assembly of the congregation of the children of Israel, and Joshua the son of Nun, and Caleb the son of Jephunneh, which were of them that searched the land, rent their clothes. And they spake unto all of the company of the children of Israel, saying, the land which we passed through there to search it, it is an exceeding good land. If the Lord delight in us, then he will bring us into this land and give it to us, a land which floweth with milk and honey. Only rebel not ye against the Lord, neither fear ye the people of the land, for they are bread for us. Their defense is departed from them, and the Lord is with us. Fear them not. Okay, so we have two reports there. Everybody said two reports. Okay, recall the report from the 10 spies, a report of evil. They brought back a negative report. They said that we are what? We are not able. We be not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we. So they saw themselves as what? Inferior, not capable. Hallelujah. And as a result of that, amen, they began to what? They began to what? Doubt God, and they made the determination that we are not going, because these people that we are facing are what? So much bigger, so much greater, and we don't have a chance, amen, to compete with these people. Amen. We are as grasshoppers. So it really boiled down, amen, to how they saw themselves. Amen. They saw themselves inferior and not capable, or not able to measure up to these people that God clearly had told them that he would give them what? Victory if they would just go over at once and what? And possess it. So their believing was not up to par. Their believing was not strong enough for them to go over, amen, to take the action that they needed to take. Now, who did have the faith? It was Caleb and who? Joshua. What did they say? They said, let us go up at once and possess it, for we are what? Well able to overcome. You know, it's really amazing how 10 people saw it one way and 2 saw it a different way. So the difference was in the way that they saw themselves on the inside and the capability that they had to what? Believe God's word. And everybody, you know, when God speaks to people today, everybody is not capable, amen, to act on the word at the same level. Some are going to have to what? They're going to have to, amen, kind of work their way up to a point where they can what? Believe God. And sometimes people can just take God at his word and just believe God and step out, amen, and really enter into whatever God has promised. So we want you to understand that the way you think is very important. Tell somebody near you, the way you think is very important. The way you think is very important. Because thinking reflects how you see yourself. All right.
on the inside.
Amen. We ought to see ourselves as God sees. Greater is he that is what? In us. Amen. I'm a giant killer. Greater is he that is inside of me than he that is in the world. Amen. If God be for me, it doesn't matter who is against me. The Lord is the strength of my life. Hey, hallelujah. Praise God. And his grace is what? Sufficient. Amen. But it takes working the word. It takes acting on the word. It takes meditation. It takes a few disciplines before you can just come to the point that you can just step out on God's word and just take God at his word. How many know it takes a while for some people? Some people just then what? Step out. Amen. If God said it, I believe it, then what? So be it. Amen. Amen. But all of us do not have the same level of faith. Now, the question came up the other night. Sister Hill asked this deep question. She said that, amen. What's more important, believing God or believing or action? Amen. Amen. That's a good question to ask. Text somebody and say, do you know the difference? Do you know which is more important? All right. What is more important, believing what God says or acting on what God says? How many believe that believing what God said is more important than acting on what God said? Raise your hand. I have a few hands. Amen. How many believe that acting on what God said is more important than believing? It's easier. Okay. All right. She wants to clarify that. All right. But we all understand that when we say believing, believing from your heart is the thing that produces action. Believing from your heart. The scripture says in Romans 10, you might want to turn there. Because you can believe the wrong thing and still get what? Results. Amen. But we're speaking about believing from our heart, believe in the word of God. Because if you believe in something that is not right, amen, you can still get what? Some type of results. You can believe wrong and what? Reap the fruits or benefits of whatever you are believing for, even if it's wrong. But we're speaking about believing the word of God. Believing the word of God. Amen. And whenever you're speaking about believing the word of God, we're speaking about believing from your heart. Believing from your heart. And we do believe that when you believe from your heart, you will act on what you believe. And that's what faith is all about. Yes. See, faith and confession, and we always say the first thing that makes faith possible, amen, faith is acting on what? The word of God. Yes. Believing is just an accumulation, is based on receiving an accumulation of knowledge. You can read the Bible, read the Word, meditate the Word of God. You're going to come up with what? Amen. Some beliefs. It's going to establish you in some area of believing if you get sufficient information. Amen. So believing comes from information, an accumulation of information that you read or you meditate or you receive in some form of another. Amen. Anytime you receive information, it's going to give you a basis for believing, amen, in whatever, amen, you are being presented. Amen. But when you act on what you believe, that's just what we call what? Faith. Acting on, everybody just said, acting on what you believe. Okay, Romans 10, and believing and confession, and we often have heard that confession is the first action that you take after you believe something. I mean, we're speaking about the Word of God. That's the first action you take. Amen. You have to come into agreement. Everybody say, you have to come into agreement. Once you receive information, you have to what? Come into agreement with it. And the way you come into agreement with that which you have believed, you begin to what? Confess with your mouth. That's the first step. And then there are other steps, there's step of obedience, whatever God tells you to do, you to, amen, even act even beyond the point of what confessing the Word of God. But the first step you want to take is to agree with it. Okay, come on, let's look at this particular scripture. Romans 10, verse 9 and 10. All right, everybody, let's read this together. Romans 10, verses 9 and 10. All right, everybody together, what does it say? Okay, verse 10. Okay, so you can see in verses 9 and 10 that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. So you see there that in order to be saved, someone has to share with you the gospel of Jesus Christ, right? You have to hear the story of our redemption, what Christ has done. And usually we consider the gospel as being Christ died, he was buried, and he was what? Raised again. Those three components are the things that you're going to have to share with people before they can come to a point of actually getting established in belief in order to act on the thing that they are believing. Amen. But after the gospel is preached, how many remember when the gospel was preached that there was a conviction and something pricked your heart and all of a sudden you had a desire to what? Repent and turn to God. You came to the altar, and when you came to the altar, someone directed you to make the confession, amen, that Jesus has what? Died and was buried and he rose again. And they admonish you to open your mouth and repeat and make that confession concerning what Christ had done for you, amen, through his redemptive work. And when you make that confession, amen, praise God, then what happened? Amen, the change began to what? Take place. Usually the tears, the brokenness, the crying, the weeping, and the sobbing. A deep conviction that Jesus Christ, amen, has broken the power of sin and death. And he has come into your life, amen, to become the Lord of your life. It brought joy. How many remember the joy? How many remember, amen, going out in the spirit, falling on the floor and praising God and shouting, getting out of control? The joy followed, but the confession had to be made before the salvation or the deliverance was experienced. Amen. That's a clear illustration of what we're speaking about, because the scripture says, for with the heart man what? Believeth unto what? Righteousness. Everybody just say that with me. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the what? Mouth, confession is what? Made unto or before you are what? Saved. So it does require, after you get sufficient information or after you are sufficiently enlightened, it does require, amen, an action on the part of the recipient. You got to take some kind of action. Amen. Praise God. And someone said that believing the word, amen, it comes natural. Believing, it's easy to believe. Amen. But many times, everybody that believe the word do not what? Act on the word, and they do not follow through and what? Receive Jesus. They hear it, they believe it, but they just, sometimes they say, I'm not ready. I got to get my life together. Amen. I got to do this. I got to clean up my life. I got to take care of some unfinished business. I got to get through what I'm going through. They give you all types of excuses, amen, showing that although they believe, but they are not ready to what? Amen. Act or release their faith. Because when you act, amen, something is going to what? Happen.
How many can say amen? For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, but with the mouth what? Confession is made unto salvation. Okay. I want you to look at 2 Corinthians 4:13, and I think that we can even go a little further, but believing and confessing are just two sides of the same coin. That's what we always, amen, that's the way we always explain it. So you can't say believing is more important than confessing, or confessing is more important than the believing. They are the two sides of what? One coin. It's amen, because you can believe, amen, and not believe with all your heart. You can believe and just give what? Mental assent to what you believe. So just become a mental thing, and that type of belief is not going to what? Bring any kind of results from God. Amen. God responds only to those that will believe from the standpoint of what? Acting on what they believe. And when we say the type of faith that pleases God is the God kind of faith, or the faith comes from the Word of God. Faith comes by what? Hearing, and hearing by what? The Word of God. All right, so let's look at 2 Corinthians 4:13. We have, and everybody read that with me, we have the same what? According as it is what? Written, I believe, and therefore have I what? Spoken. And the brother Dean began to, boy, when he touched that today, I said, uh-oh, that's exactly, amen, what God has spoken to me. I believe, and therefore have I what? Spoken. We also believe, and therefore do what? Speak. Amen. So we see there, believing with your heart is the only way you can receive from God, other than through the manifestations of the gifts of the Spirit. Amen. Believing with your heart is the only way you can receive from God. Okay, you can receive from God without believing from your heart. Amen. But it's only going to be through the manifestation of the gifts of the Holy Spirit. If God wills to do something or work a miracle in your life, amen, without you believing anything at all, He can will to do it if He what chooses to do it. He can just what work through somebody through a gift of the Spirit. I know a whole lot of people get healed and get miracles wrought in their lives without even giving Jesus their lives. You don't have to believe anything when a gift is in operation, but it only happens as God wills it. It might be every 5 years, it might be every 2 years, it can be at any point, but it's not something that God does on a consistent basis. Everybody say amen. So when it comes to which is more important, believing or confessing or acting on the Word of God, amen, nothing is going to happen unless both are what? Evident. You got to believe in your heart, amen, and what? Act, amen, if you want the faith process to be complete. Amen. Nothing is going to happen. Now, someone might ask, which is easier to do, believe or to act on the Word of God? And I'm going to just let you respond from the audience. How many believe believing is easier than acting? Raise your hand. Now, we're not comparing the two, but which is easier for you to do? Raise your hand. Those that believe that believing is easier, raise your hand. All right? Those that believe acting is easier, raise your hand. All right, praise God. All right, well, you can believe. It doesn't matter which way you believe that. But I know that in Mark 11:23, just turn there just for a moment, you can observe something that Jesus said in Mark 11. We know that believing got to be from your heart. And believing comes from receiving the Word of God. Faith comes by hearing. Faith comes by what? Hearing, faith comes by what? Hearing and hearing and hearing and hearing. Okay, so whatever you believe has to be based on the Word of God if God is going to what? Be involved in it. It has to be based on His Word. Okay, let's look at Mark 11, 23. It says this, everybody with me, it says, "But verily I say unto you that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou what? Removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith," S-A-I-T-H, said, "shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he said." Okay, now we've heard this before, that in that particular verse, how many times do we see the word "say" or some derivatives of "say"? How many times? "For verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall what? Say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he said shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he said." In that particular verse, how many times are we admonished to say? Okay, we are admonished how many times? Okay, how many times are we admonished to believe in that particular verse? How many times are we admonished to believe? Amen. Everybody went to devil. How many times?
Once.
Once, okay. So this is what Brother Hagin always taught. He says that you're going to have to admonish people a lot more in the arena of saying than you're going to have to admonish them in the area of believing. So I guess that would prove y'all's point that believing is easier to get people believing than to get them active or confessing. Now, I'm just going to say it from the perspective of a pastor. After people do get saved,